Mike, you've been here before. Yeah, years, I know, but I was here too, and I remember. Hey, Mike, welcome back. It's good to see you.
I got another car.
And yeah, we have our special guest, Durham, who is going to be, we're going to see. It's an experiment, because this is, after all, experimental theater. Hey, Durham, welcome back. Thanks for changing your flight. Would you really change your flight?
What happened?
Be here? Thank you. I appreciate it. So, so everyone knows what we're doing, right? We're going to work together for a minute, and then we're going to talk about our work for a little bit longer than that. So, and today, because I have to go to, like, a PTA meeting-ish, we're going to work for 15 minutes instead of the usual time. So we'll leave more time for talking. I just didn't want to use up all the time working on my talk, okay? So what we're going to do, where is my trusty? And Brittany's got one, too. I'm going to use my phone today. So basically, we're going to work for 15 minutes, and then we're going to talk about your work and your creative process. And any distractions, or what we consider to be distractions today, that you might hear or see, and just use it as an opportunity to up your ability to focus, because that's what it's about today. And we'll set the times for 15 minutes, and then we'll begin. Okay, let's go. You ready? Did you start?
Yes.
Yeah, we're gonna. So we just work just today. It's just for a short amount of time because the PTA wants me to sit there. So right now we're going to do the dialogue part of the show. And for those of you who haven't been here before, this is where you talk to me about your work. Okay. So I know the title of the show is called Watch Me Work, but the me and the title is you. And you know me by now. If you don't know me by now, Crystal will explain me to you. You're all made up. Where are you? What? Did you get the role or something?
Oh, I wanted to say, but no.
Well, you look good.
Thank
I
you.
Like a cat.
Well, there's time.
There is. Does anybody have a question? About your work? This is what happens when you graduate and then you come back and I'll go, we'll be you guys. And Ricardo too. Because it's been a while. Okay, anyway. Anybody have questions about your work and your creative process? You don't know. I got to come here. And so if a four-year-old can concentrate his energy,
oh my God.
Then you can too. And we talked about it before we came to the building. And he was like, okay, I understand. Your work, your creative process. Yes, Amber, and I just met you 2 weeks ago. Remind me of your name.
Sorry, Andrew.
Andrew. Hey, Andrew.
Hi.
Hey, hi.
So I was wondering, when you finish a draft,
right?
And only you have seen it, and only you have read it, no one else has, and then you present it to people, they have ideas, other people have ideas. I'm looking for the best way to not be precious about what I've written,
mm-hmm.
And it's hard for me to. I do want to change it. I do want it to get better.
Right.
But I look at it and I go, but it's done. And I want to know how I can, maybe how you have done it in the past. I don't know if this is easy.
My agent's calling, really. But I'm not going to answer. That's really funny. So,
how do you kind of go about, do you want to add to it or...
Yeah.
Or change your first draft. I mean, I'm writing new scenes, but then again, it's hard to edit what I've already written.
Right.
You know what I mean?
I understand.
So, I just want to know from your perspective how you do it.
That's great. So everybody here, Andrew, so he's written a draft, a first draft of something, right?
Yeah.
And he feels good about it. He's ready to show it to folks. And he doesn't want to be precious with it, right? He does want it to get better. And he's cool about changing things. But how do you go forward? And everybody's like, but you're done. You feel like you're done. And when you said that, the nods of heads around the room. Yeah, right? So you feel like you're done. And yet, you're going to go forward. Is it work for the stage, I guess?
It is.
Okay.
For stage.
Okay. So it's a collaborative process. And you know from being in class what that's all about. You know from your career. How do you go about writing this? And this is the tricky thing. So, how many people are giving you notes and feedback?
Well, there are my class of
okay.
14 other actors who are also writing.
Did you 14 other actors.
No offense.
Who are also writing.
God.
Okay.
Sold myself down the road.
Join the club in black shoes.
But
yeah,
and
right.
Also a writer who's written a few pieces that I've seen in the city.
Okay.
And so they're giving me all this feedback. They want it's about the blues. They want me to listen to more songs. I listen to the songs. They don't fit. you know, and so I write new scenes, and then I'm like, okay, but now I have to change this scene, and now I have to change that, and I want their. I don't know, I don't want to lose what I have, but I also do want to shed what's not.
Right. You don't want to lose what you have, but you do want to shed what's not needed, right? You think of a snake, you know, which he or he sheds. They don't, leave everything. They just, like you're saying, shed what's not needed. It's a class that's happening this semester. I'm sorry, it's not because I'm thinking of naming names or anything, but it's very tricky because are you expected to finish it in a certain amount of time?
I am. It's actually gonna go up at NYU.
The free play or?
Yeah,
the free play. Okay. Tricky, very tricky, because sometimes my suggestions might not be useful given your situation. Because I would ordinarily I would suggest after you finish your draft, ordinarily I would say, you know, let it cool, you know what I mean? Which might not be helpful if you got some kind of class thing. Let it cool and only show it to people who love you more than they love their ideas being in your work, which might not apply necessarily because you can't choose who you want to, you know. But maybe you can. So this is you know the play. So what does he do? He dissembles. He does some like.
He breaks down what it is that we do and why we do it, why we want to kill ourselves.
Right, and he pretends. Right, there's a lot of pretending going on. Smile, still be a villain. Well, that is his Claudius. But so there's a lot of fronting going on, and there's a lot of like, yeah, cool, man, that sounds cool. That's cool. And like, basically, you're saying talk to the hand. Okay, so you're gonna have to, you might have to do that in your class. Not in a mean way and not because their feedback isn't worthy of consideration, but because maybe you should only be listening to two people in the class when you have to listen to 14. Okay, and everybody in the class is actually gonna do this. So you need to develop the ability to, and maybe when you listen to them, do you take notes?
Yes.
Okay, so use that as a shield. Okay, your notebook, and I would suggest taking notes in an actual notebook. Okay, it's flat. There you are writing. It gives you a very obvious activity. Here I am doing this while you're talking to me. Or if you're left, you know what I'm saying? Blah 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 blah. Listen to more somehow. I don't know what blues you're into, but listen to more Muddy Waters. Listen to Devil Got My Woman, you know?
More old track from Robert Johnson era.
Okay. Sun House, Robert Johnson.
Yeah.
Okay. So listen to Charlie Patton. Whatever they're saying, you can write it down and use the writing as a filter. Okay? So I would suggest you start taking notes and filtering out and not do everything they say, but after you take their notes, let it cool. Don't react right away. Say yes, thank you to everything. And then after like 24 hours after you sleep on it, maybe go through and look and circle the ones that really make sense to you. There might only be one. There might be none. This class might be about you learning to take notes and less about you learning to write something fantastical.
Right.
Well, although what might happen.
Yeah, it's going to be the first piece I've ever put up.
Right.
I think I'm actually all right with the notes. I'm actually good with the feedback.
Okay.
I'm okay with taking it. I do say yes, smile,
sure.
Write it down.
Good.
And I don't use everything I get.
Good. Okay.
I guess maybe it's more a question for myself, how I kill my own darlings in support of my own needs for this script. Maybe I'm not formulating this.
No. But my feeling is that we should worry less about killing our own darlings and taking on board what someone else wants. That's just my gut. I've met a lot of people, a lot of writers, and most of the time, we're too willing. You see the nods over here? These people are graduating. They graduated from the program. So they're saying, yeah, y'all know what I'm talking about? We're more apt to take on notes that might not be suitable than to stand up for what we really think is good. That's just because we're in the arts and we're kind of soft, which is okay. Which is actually okay. It's okay to be soft. It's good. It's actually a great thing to be soft in this world. And resilient, and have resilience at the same time. So, just find the notes that you really, that really, really mean something to you. You need to go pee? Okay. Give mommy 1 second. Do you really need to go pee? Can you find?
weeks, and he knows how to do everything. Good job. Okay.
Well done. So Durham learned two things this summer. He learned how to go to the bathroom when he needs to, in the toilet, and he learned how to snap his fingers. But anyway, does that make sense?
It does, yeah.
Keep checking back in. We'll come back. We'll keep checking back. Anybody else have a question?
Yeah, Siobhan.
You were mentioning cooling.
Yeah.
So, say you've written a play, and then you put it away.
Yes.
And you let it cool off.
Yes.
What's the first thing you do when you're ready to come back to that?
Oh, what a great question. So Siobhan says, say you've written a play, and you've rewritten it, and you put it away, and you let it cool off, and then you're taking it out of the drawer, the vault. You take it out and you unwrap it. And what's the first thing you do? I would say reread it.
Okay.
Standing up.
Okay.
Out loud.
Okay.
And if it's really long, you're gonna get tired. But so what? You know what I'm saying? Reread it.
Yeah.
Standing up out loud. Okay? So that would mean that you print it out. Because a lot of times you write drafts, but you write text. You do 10 drafts, you don't get around to print it. So make sure you print it out. Don't read it off your iPad or phone or whatever. And try to read it quickly, because you're going to be reading out loud, so try to read it quickly. And, you know, people might say, don't read it with a pen or pencil in hand. If you're like, try it. Just read it fast. Read it like someone else wrote it.
Okay.
This is also what you can do.
Read it standing up, you're an actor, standing up, read it like someone else wrote it. Because what's going to happen is the script isn't going to stick, and you'll feel it. It's going to catch you. Whoa! It's going to like, snag. Dumb. Oh gosh, I ain't talking. You're going to be able to hear that very clearly.
Yeah, cool.
And then you just mark those places. You can circle them whatever you want, you know. But don't get into like rewriting. There you are, standing there. Don't do that yet. That's later.
Okay?
Good question. Yeah. That's an advanced question. But it applies also to what you're going through. Yeah. Anybody else? Crystal got a question. Hey, Crystal
tweeted
in last week.
Yeah. I didn't make any sense.
But we tried. I was like,
it's so funny because my daughter wanted to watch too, and my computer doesn't play very loud, so we both have the computers on either side of our ears, and it was crazy. So what I did, like I said, I have a two-person reading,
right?
Or me and a person reading.
Great.
And that's, I think, next week, so that's locked in.
Great-ish.
And then, so I'm starting to work on this new piece, which has been a while, so. It's almost like the same process. I don't know if you remember, in the very, very, very beginning, where it's kind of like, I don't know where the story's landing. What I meant was, I did have a dream about it, and that's how it made me want to write it.
Right.
It was literally beginning, middle, and end given to me.
Okay.
But I never felt like, I guess, ready to try to execute it.
Right.
And so there are these two, it's two women, black and white, early 60s.
Right.
And I only hear one voice right now. And it's not really, what I meant by translate is that I wish I could write it as I dreamt it, but I cannot.
Right.
So I'm relying on trying to hear their voices now, as you said.
Right.
But I only hear one voice. I only hear one woman.
Do you know which one? You only hear one. Does it matter? So you only hear one voice. Do you mean, so Crystal's writing a new play. She dreamt it. She had it sort of beginning and the end came to her in a dream. And she's sitting down to write it. It's a two-character play. And for some reason, she can only hear one voice. Is the other voice like silent? Like one voice says, hey, how you doing? Want to go to the store? I'm going to get some potatoes. You want anything? You know, what's wrong? You know,
I think what it is that, kind of like with the previous play, it's these two people and one voice is just louder. She's not like extroverted louder, but I hear her or understand more of who she is.
Right.
More so than I do the other person. And I'm almost kind of fearing that it's possible that this character, the second character, may be similar to the person in the play that I just have been trying to finish up and rewrite. So I don't know if I hear a new person, or if it's just repetitive,
right.
Or if it's new. I hear one new voice, I hear one new person,
right.
But I'm not hearing.
So you hear one new person distinctly, and you're sure and solid. And the other character, and you're not so sure. You have a lot of questions about. Okay, this is something. One thing that's going on. You're editing and judging your writing before you're writing. Okay. Yeah. So you go down. You sit down to write. You dreamt that you have the beginning, middle, and end. You have them written out. This happens. This happens. And this happens. You got that. So you're not going to like forget it.
No.
Good. Okay. So. You're sitting down to write, you can hear one voice distinctly, and the other voice, well, I don't know if it's a new character, I don't know, it might be an old character, it might be, I'm just saying these things, we all go through this. I don't know if it's, it might not, it's not. Okay? Write it, just write it. It can be like, shitty, you know? It can be not so good. It can be not as good, it can be not as distinct, it can be not as fleshed out. It can be limping halfway there. It can be crawling. It can be like, I didn't get it right yet. It can be just okay. It can be awful. It can be stupid. It can be the worst character ever. I dare you. And I bet yours won't nearly be as bad as mine. Because I've written some, take me to the toilet. You know what I'm saying? Like, oh, I can't. You know, right? Okay? So go ahead and write it as best you can. Work quickly. Work quickly. You have to, the censor, this is the thing about the critic, your inner critic, I don't know about censors, but my inner critic is very slow. My inner critic has a walker.
Mommy?
Got a walker.
Mommy?
Yes?
Which train is talking
about? The bullet train just broke. Okay, give mommy a second, okay? My inner critic has a walker. He, she, it, I'm not sure, is very slow.
I think you should.
I mean, not to diss old people or anything, or people with walkers, it's not about that. It's just they've been around forever. They're very opinionated, and being around forever and being very opinionated makes you slow, and you need something to lean on. Okay? So if you write quickly, if I write quickly, I find that I can out sprint. The critic, the inner critic is like, they're not as audible. Or maybe it's just the pounding of my feet on the road that drowns out all of their sound. Write quickly. So set yourself, what's your writing time now? Well, how much do you sit down? You sit down for an hour, 20 minutes? What?
Varies on kids.
Okay. What is it? 30 minutes?
There.
What can you give me?
Here 20, here 5, here an
okay,
hour.
Great. Write quickly. Just write as fast as you can. Give it up 5 minutes. 10 minutes, whatever you got, make sure you write it quickly. Or typing is good too. Okay? So work quickly. And you just won't have time to BS yourself. BSing yourself takes time. You ever notice? Man, right? You're trying to get ready to go out for an evening or something. And it's like, it'll take you 10 minutes to get dressed, but then it takes you like 30 minutes to tell yourself that you shouldn't be wearing that. Okay, just go. Just do it. Anybody else? Yes, you.
Hi, I'm
Amy. Hi, Amy.
It's my first time.
Hey, good to see you.
This is sort of like a basic question,
sure,
I guess.
Sure.
But, when you're trying to write something and you want it to be true and genuine and something that is true to you, how do you sort of silence all those voices that are saying, like, we already know this, or like, how do you write something that is true and not something that you think people want to read, or like,
right.
It's like, you know, this is a story that isn't in the public space, but
right.
You want it to make it true as well as needed.
That makes sense.
Hold on a second. What do you mean?
This
can't.
I
need you to put it through other
trains
for just a
second.
Okay. That's okay.
I'll fix it later. Okay, so how do you write something? So it's true. Is it true to your life?
I'll give an example. So basically, like, in a writing class, I'll be like, oh, people explain their background.
Right, okay.
And I'll be like, oh, I grew up in Hong Kong and China and stuff. They'll be like, oh, that's so interesting. You should, like, write about that.
Right.
they're interested in that
right.
story or like wanting to know what that's like, but I'm like, okay, and part of me, of course, like things will be about that, but then it's like I have this inner struggle of being like, am I just catering to what
right.
this audience of people, maybe like in the States
right,
or in
right,
this
right.
class, want
right.
to read it?
Right.
Ooh,
that's
yes.
a lot. That's a huge.
Yeah.
No. And it's a really good question, and it's a huge question. So Amy's got this question. She's writing something about her, kind of from personal experience, you could say. And
Mommy.
You've got all these questions. You've got all these questions as you're writing. I would suggest the same thing what Crystal said. Your censor, your inner critic, you have a lot of people talking at you, right?
Yeah.
And what you need to do is write quickly. So do you have a writing time, a time every day set aside for writing? Okay, so what's your favorite time of the day?
What's your favorite time of the day? Morning, noon, evening?
Probably really late evening.
Really late, so you're like a night owl.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're a night owl. So what I want you to try to do is, do you have a timer? I would suggest not your phone, but like a kitchen timer. If you don't have time to go out and buy a kitchen timer, use your phone for now, but when you graduate, or have a little bit of time, get a kitchen timer, and set it for, let's just say, I don't know what sounds good, 15 minutes? We just did the 15 minutes. Were you here?
Yeah, I was drawing.
Okay, drawing's cool.
Yeah.
Drawing's cool. But 15 minutes, did that seem too much, or did that seem good amount?
That's a good amount.
Okay. So, did it seem like too much, or like, do you want more than 15 minutes?
I'd probably do 30 minutes.
Okay, good. So what we're doing is we're asking Amy choose her favorite time of day. So we're not saying, get up in the morning and write. We're saying, what time do you feel like you can write, okay? Right? Because it's about you. It's not about me, it's about you. So 30 minutes writing every evening. Okay? So just make sure you put the time on. And sit there with your notebook or with your laptop or whatever you have. And just write, okay? And write quickly. Are you pretty good?
Yeah.
Good. Great. Because the sense, remember, she's slow. They're all slow. They're weighed down by their ideas and opinions. You know, they're like a great chorus, but they're really old. I've got something to tell you. You know what I'm saying? They're probably not even walking. They're probably just lying down. They're probably just shouting at you. You know what I'm saying? So 30 minutes a day, write quickly. And every time you hear one of those people, are you writing for them? Are you writing just what these people want to hear? All those comments, talk to the hand. Talk to the hand. Keep going. Okay? That works for me. So why don't you try it? So again, speed. Okay? It's 5:45. Okay. Anybody else? You want to stop it?
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes.
What's your name?
Oh, Alexis.
Alexis. Oh, you were here last time.
Okay, hey, welcome back.
So, I just graduated school in May.
Yes.
And I had this, I'm okay with like reading 5 books at once, but then I know I'll finish like 3 of them. That's the, that, but then I'm a slow reader, so that's all. But then I have a problem where I cheat on my pieces. So I keep a book where I keep all the ideas that I brainstorm. Like June was a really good month for me because I had just come out of school and I had all these ideas
right,
and I put them
right,
all in a notebook.
Right.
And then recently I found a piece and I'm like, okay, this is the one I really want to focus on. I feel like this is a really good solid place. And now I'm in that part where it's like, hey, this other idea looks really good now. Like, I kind of want to start on that.
Keep talking. Look at them. They're going like,
I'm like, you know, like, this can, like, sit. And, like, I don't want to, because I have a bad habit of not finishing things. And now that I'm out of school, I don't, like, want to. Now that I'm out of school, I have no one else to, like, tell me, like, oh, you have a deadline. You have
right,
people
right,
counting
right.
on you. Like,
right.
nobody's counting on
right,
me.
Right, right, right. Okay, right. But
so
this is what we think. Yeah, but this is what we think. But just because we're out of school and we don't have anybody to give us a deadline, that no one's counting on us. And guess what? The world is counting on you. The whole world. Like everybody. We're all counting on you. I'm counting on you. They're counting on you. We're all counting on you. The internet, the online community is counting on you. People you've never met in like, Wendell, remember in India?
No.
The cool people in India. They're counting on you. They don't even know you. They're counting on you. No pretending. No, but just know that we're kind of, we're all rooting for you. We're all cheering you on, if that helps. Okay? And now, as far as deadlines, how do you make a deadline if you're not in school? You make one up yourself. Right? You make one. I make deadlines all the time. I have to learn, I have to do this, I have to learn this to my partner this time. I have to write this by this time. But I'm just doing my own work on my own. Okay? So you can do that on your own. It will make you more effective in responding to the deadline. When you get a commission or whatever you're going to get, you get some kind of work for hire, you'll be better at it because you will have, your deadlines will be coming from inside instead of imposed by the outside. Okay? And then how do you, what, you got that list of wonderful projects and how are you going to choose which project and all of them look good and everything? That's called just stick with it. Just stick with it. That's, again, that's a variation of Amy's voices. That's a variation of these voices that tell you that you're, just get to the end. Okay? You have to just get to the end. Mine. Your knows how to finish a job. I tell him, just finish the job. Keep your focus and finish the job. And you know, finish the job. You know, just finish the job. It's okay if it's not brilliant, great, prize worthy. Who cares? Finish the job. I'm telling you.
Okay.
You know, so like 5 years from now, if you come up in here and tell me, yeah, I'll finish it again. We'll have a special part. A special.
Yeah, I remember you.
We did. I've been working on a lot of different things. See, I'm being stupid, so you don't have to. Okay? So finish the job. Stick with it. I don't care if it's crap when you're done. I don't care. No one's going to judge you. They're not going to judge you. You're going to be happy because you will have taken again. You will have taken that step. And you won't be one of those people when you're like 95 going, I had a novel in me. Never got around to write it. Oh, you don't want to be that. You want to be the person who said, hey, I wrote some things. And people say, did it get published or produced? I say, yeah, I had a good thing. You know, then they're just being stupid. But they'll be, you know, and you'll go to the, you know, places and tell people that you write things, and they'll tell yourself that you write things, or tell yourself that you did the things you always wanted to do. There's nothing that is right? Please don't walk back. It'd be a shame if you do that way. Anybody else?
Yeah.
Oh, I know. Just making sure. Okay. Anybody? Okay.
All right, so I have a character in my script who,
yes,
I find, I finish reading it, she's like cheats on people and lies, and I'm finishing the script and I want her to be the one that people are rooting for, but I'm looking at her going, gosh, she's so mean. So how like, do you have a way that you, like, if you ever looked at a character and go, God, this person just seems evil, do you have a way to humanize them? Is it like memories? Is it like go back in the past? Like, I'm really wondering, like, I don't want her to come off as like a two-time and mean person.
But she is.
She is in a way, but I mean, there's so many of us in this world who are, and unfortunately, and so I want to find out why people do it. You know, it's not. I don't believe it's because they're evil. You know, so I need to find a way to make her like me.
Well. I would. So you're. How to make her likable, how to humanize her. So.
Maybe that's.
No. The question maybe is how to tell the whole truth about her. You know what I mean? How to tell the whole truth. You know? You want to tell the whole truth about her, right? So right now you're just doing the sexy, interesting, cool dance around part. You're not telling the whole truth. And this is not because you want people to like her. I mean, that's, you know, this is not because you want to humanize her. Because you want to get to the it of her S-H-I-T. You want to look her in the eye, and you want to tell the whole truth. As best you can, given your abilities at this point in your life. Right? Okay. So because we often think, you know, we get these notes, humanize them, So people will watch your play or read your novel or whatever, and it's a decent note, but it sends us in the wrong direction, I think, as a writer. I think you want to tell the truth about her. You don't want to turn her? Does that make sense?
Okay.
And she might be likable, she might not be likable. What are you going to do, take a poll in the theater every night? Did you like her? Did you like her? Did you like her? If you read the review and you find out she's not likable, will you have failed?
Right. I mean, you've read Richard III.
Yeah.
Okay. You've read the Scottish play.
Well, we got to save this for Lucas's mommy.
You've read the Scottish play, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Were they likable or were they watchable?
Watchable.
Okay, they were watchable.
They were more than watchable.
Yeah, there you go, right? Tomorrow. Do you think he wrote that because he wanted his guy to be likable? Oh, let's make him likable. Let's write it tomorrow.
No.
I don't think so. I mean, I don't know, but I don't think so. I think he wrote it because he wanted to get to the end of his SHIT, right?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm spelling because we know. Does that make sense? Yeah? Okay, did you have a question? Yeah, you had a comment. Good.
Lend support to that, and that what I was working on today is I'm reading for applications.
Yes.
And I just read a play where the protagonist was very unlikable. Like, I couldn't quite relate to her, but I understood her, and she wanted things, and she had this beautiful emotional life.
Yes.
And she wasn't necessarily my type of person.
Yes.
But I'm recommending the play being read, and I think this playwright is really good, and you know, so because there were other things that allowed me to connect, I didn't need to like her. I did understand her.
Mm-hmm.
But,
mm-hmm.
You know,
good.
It was just serendipitous.
Anybody else?
I was just gonna say what I always want is just the truth of the character. That's really all I want. I don't have to like them. I don't even have to necessarily care about them.
Mm-hmm.
But I want the truth, and I'll let the truth direct me on how I should feel about them.
Yeah.
But I understand, because you know, quite frankly, like people like that, for example, like your character doing stuff like that. Lots of time, that's a front for something else that's going on.
Right.
Like the kid at school gives a teacher hell and never listens and never does the homework and is always rude and obnoxious in class, never listens and drives the teacher to their wits' end. But what the teacher or kids don't know, everybody thinks he's just a jerk, they don't know is that kid has got an alcoholic father at home that's beating his wife, his mother every day, and has almost beat him to death a few times. And he's dealing with all sorts of other stuff and walking through a gang-infested neighborhood and et cetera, right?
Mm-hmm.
So all that crap at school is just a big old fun.
But again, we don't show that backstory or that crap at school for the kid to humanize them. We're just trying to show the whole story. Does that make sense? It's a different kind of way of thinking about it.
Not to say that we don't humanize them, but like, look, I need this person to get from point A to point B, and this person has to help them get there, even if it's like the most horrible thing they have to do to them, or it's just
right. Alexa says, do you think as writers, do you think we put people or characters in positions to
use people? Just like
use people. You could turn it around, actually, and say that characters put us in positions. That we are in service of the spirit and not a manipulator of the spirit. The spirit being the creative spirit. You're in service of it. I know you guys are. You floor to your mind up here. I know you're in service of the creative spirit. You know? You are. You are. People, you. You and you and you and you. All y'all. You know?
Wouldn't be here if we weren't.
Right, yeah. In so many ways. Garland says we wouldn't be here if we weren't. We wouldn't be here, not just in the lobby of the public theater, but we wouldn't be here like on the
character. My experience, I had a reading for one of my plays, and the character is like this actress, and you know, she's kind of self-seeking, but she's married, and her marriage is strained, and someone was like, oh, she's such a bee, okay, and like, you know, I don't want to care for her, you know, I don't even care what happens to her, and I mean, I was hurt, of course, because I wrote it, and, but at the same time, I ended up talking to other, like, women about this character, and realized, you know, there aren't many lead character, you know, female characters that are very strong, that make decisions that may or may not affect, that works mostly in their favor, not really in servitude to their, maybe their spouse, or, you know, especially in our age now, our generation, and it kind of made me challenge myself to say, you know what, like, what if them reading or hearing these characters, that this character in per se that they don't like or even care about, what will they go home thinking about as far as who they come into contact with? Because obviously they know somebody like this. Right. Obviously there's something that they're in tune with that is a turn off, but you're forced to watch this person that maybe in reality you just turn the other way. You have to watch them or listen to them for an hour and a half or 2 hours, and you got to be there with them. So in a way you also have to kind of question, why do I feel this way about this person? What does that say? I think it forces people to do soul searching for themselves, and I've learned to kind of take that burden of saying, oh, I, you know, making them likable, making them, I'm like, this chick exists, you know, like, they're probably in my neighborhood, you know, but it forces me also as a writer, because I, same thing, I didn't want to write it, because I didn't want to, I know how she's coming across. But I was like, but she's real, and she has a voice.
But
and
a lot of times when we, again, without the tomorrow speech in the Scottish play, he wouldn't be such a great character. And so we miss an opportunity to pick a great character because we're just pushing some buttons and being very satisfied with that. Do you understand what I'm saying? And if we just think of that play and that speech, we can go, wow. When he says that speech, you go, whoa, this guy is he. You say, yeah, he does that. but you know what I mean? Exactly.
Right.
You had a question. Did you have a question? No, then we might be able to. Go ahead.
Why is it a long?
Yeah, it's a long. It's a long. People got questions.
What? You're doing great, though. You're doing great.
Sometimes our mind is like that. Sometimes your mind is just like this.
I just wanted to ask, you mentioned in the beginning, talking about distractions.
Yes.
And distractions that we all deal with.
Right.
I was wondering, like, what's your biggest distraction? How do you... Why are you telling me? Oh, yes, of course.
That's
why
I brought
her.
Okay.
My biggest distraction is, like, the internet, for instance. Or right now I have a cat.
A cat.
She's insane.
She's insane.
So,
right.
Yeah.
Well, exactly. My take is that anything that you want to make a distraction will be a distraction. You see what I'm saying? It really is how you focus on it. Because Durham's four. Durham can run around this area here, and I can still have a conversation with you. Watch. There you go. And that moment a few minutes ago, initially when he said, can I go to the bathroom? And I was like, how do I help you go to the bathroom and have a conversation? And we turn and see an angel. There's someone to help. You see what I'm saying? Anything can be a distraction if you allow it to be a distraction. Sometimes, some days you want to be distracted. Some days you don't want to work, okay? Some days you just don't want to work, okay? Some days you're on the internet all day reading about Kanye and whatever. Look how big it is. Oh my goodness gracious. You know what I'm saying? Whatever you're saying. Okay? So you need to find ways to manage your distractions, whether it's your cat or your four-year-old or the internet. What are my biggest distractions? I mean, everything is distracting, and yet nothing is distracting. This is why today I wanted to do this. Because micromanage and try to police. And you know what I'm saying? Or I could just maintain this right here. And it's good. And at the end of the time, you go, it's one of the things you're lucky. At the end of the time, you go, wow, I accomplished something. I play music also in a band, and I play with this great musician, a shredder, who's Steve Barganetti. He's a brilliant musician. And he often says, like, create distractions and then practice. Don't try to get, you know, the padded room where nobody's going to talk to you and all that kind of thing. Let the distractions start going. And see what you can do through the distractions.
Okay, anybody else have a burning question or we'll stop? I'll go to the PTA. Yeah, Garland.
You're going out of time. You can change your tickets. Come to your show. God bless you. Thank you.
The bill's approved. No, I just want to just tack on one little tiny other thing for Andrew here, which is, you know, I said I want to understand them and go one step further. Why do I want to understand them? It's because I want to feel something. Feel something. The only way I can feel something about them is if I understand them. I understand where they're coming from. But the bottom line is I want to feel something. I want to walk away having felt something. Like I will walk away from a top dog underdog and have really felt something because of those two brothers and what I've learned about those two brothers through watching them interact and hearing about their story and hearing them reveal who they are.
Yeah.
And I walk away satisfied because I felt something.
Right.
That's all I want.
You guys are great. Look at all these people here today. Yay! Thank you guys for coming today. And we're not going to be next week. Tell us, Brittany, what are we doing?
October 19th.
October the 19th. Okay, so we got them. Thank you so much for coming. Yay! You did well.